One second.
Oh, are there some more coming?
It's a group, yeah.
Okay, never mind.
Scratch that.
Right, exactly. All right. Yep. The backup.
I think so. Sorry, we had this stuff so much in our mouths.
Are we good, Hillary? Okay. I'll do that again. I'm very pleased once again to welcome Anna Guerrero to SFI. She'll be here all week because she's also participating in the postdoc conference Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. And Anna is a PhD candidate working with Manfred Laubickler, who's on the line, I believe, in the Center for Biology and Society at Arizona State University. She studies history and philosophy of science and is particularly interested in how people make and use images of normally invisible entities like cells and microorganisms. In addition to her training in history and philosophy, Anna uses methods from microbiology, scientific illustration, and computational humanities. And for her PhD work, she's researching the roles that images play in the evolution of the concept of microbial biofilms. And for her postdoctoral work, she intends to investigate how to study images as historical ledgers and social agents in science. And she's also the recipient of a JSMF postdoctoral fellowship, and she would like to bring that to SFI.
That's my whole first slide spiel. You did it.
Yay, so take it away. You can skip your first slide.
Awesome. All right. Thank you, everyone, for coming today. I guess we'll just get into it since that covers me for the most part. If it wants to go. Okay, cool. So I'm sure you're all aware that there are many ways to study and model complex knowledge systems. Today, the knowledge system that I want to talk about is science, and particularly science, something that is human and socio-technical and makes knowledge about physical entities. So you might also be aware that studying knowledge systems in this way and science in this way is not necessarily a new thing. So the main way to accomplish this historically, when people wanted to learn about science as a knowledge system, you study the evolution of concepts through scientific discourse. So that includes asking first when and how innovative concepts get introduced and established in a knowledge system, and then when and how concepts spread, influence, and change over time. And so there are an abundance of quantitative tools to do this, which includes natural language processing, topic modeling, and bibliometric networks. And a common theme you might notice in these is that they sort of privilege words. And I think this audience will be especially sympathetic to the idea that words, even in a complex knowledge system like science, is not the only way, and maybe not even the most important way, that information gets communicated. So I think treating language as the primary locus of conceptual generation and change in science can be limiting. And today I'd like to show you how we can expand on that. So historians, philosophers, anthropologists, sociologists outside of complex systems research have documented tons of cases in which images were the catalyst for conceptual innovation and evolution in science. I'm sure you can all think of examples from math, physics, and astronomy. But today I'm going to focus on biology and particularly microbiology. So in microbiology, illustrations to photomicrographs, they allow biologists to record observations, to articulate and negotiate concepts, and perhaps most importantly, to communicate those concepts. And microbiology, by definition, is concerned with subvisual entities. And because of that, the concepts are inseparable from images and the technologies that scientists use to build those images. So shortly, images shape scientists' concepts. And so here are some examples. We have X-ray crystallography, pivotal for solidifying the 3D structure of DNA. A single conceptual diagram about protein signaling set the agenda in cell biology for several decades. And an electron micrograph of mitochondria inspired the first theories and experiments regarding oxidative phosphorylation. But that's only half the story. Scientists use concepts to shape images. The common misconception that scientists only create objective depictions of the physical world kind of obscures the fact that these prior concepts are embedded in every image. So for example, naturalists in the 17th century, they didn't just look at plant tissues under a microscope and see regular spherical shapes and say like, those are the basic units of life. Instead, they already thought that macro living organisms were made of some perfect basic unit. So when they got microscopes powerful enough to see this regular structure, they deemed it significant. Cool. So when scientists create an image, their methods of looking and interpreting and making are inherited such that scientific images are inseparable from the complex knowledge systems from which they emerge. And once these images become established in their knowledge system, they go on to influence more researchers who make more images that make more concepts and so on. And this fundamental image concept network is pretty inherent to biology, but science more broadly. But for the most part, people studying science as a knowledge system have studied only evolving concepts without addressing the half that is evolving images. And I would like to change that with complex systems methods, mainly by treating images as social agents and historical ledgers. So I'm now going to move through four cases in microbiology that show what we can learn about knowledge systems by taking images seriously in this way. In my first case, designing a cyborg self focuses on images as social agents. So first, a bit of context. At an NSF Rules of Life Challenge in 2018, a bunch of researchers got together. There were physicists, computer scientists, engineers, cell biologists, and a bunch of social scientists. They formed their own teams, and then they were each given large amounts of money to build synthetic cells, the definition of which were up to each team. And so I was on one of these teams as a social scientist. And this group is the group I would become part of. And they were called the cyborg cell group. And this was the concept they were using to build their synthetic cell. And so admittedly, at first, they told me that the reason they picked cyborg cell was because it was catchy and exciting. So there wasn't a ton of serious considerations as to what that might mean. But it actually ended up being a really It was advantageous for the group to have that framework because it actually allowed the social scientists to ask an important question, which was, how will you know if you were succeeding at building a cyborg cell if you don't have a very well-established definition for a regular cell? So, great. When we started working together remotely in 2020, I led our first group exercise, and my goal was to find out how our team conceptualized cells relative to cyborg cells. And I wanted to do this for two reasons. First, I thought that having a normal cell image as a foil to a cyborg cell would really pull out the most important characteristics that our researchers thought were important for a cell and for a cyborg cell. And second, even though this group communicates often through words and they will probably publish papers with words, the most important product of this project will be a physical entity. There will be no words. It'll be something they will study through images under a microscope. And so I assumed what our researchers imagined cells and cyborg cells to look like was far more important than anything I could verbalize, at least at this early stage in the project. So we did this drawing exercise. Everyone drew a cell, and then everyone drew a cyborg cell. And then we went around and showed each other and talked about it. And I won't get into each one individually, but my favorite one was that my advisor, Jane, who is a historian of cell biology, her cyborg cell, she drew a truck inside a cell, moving little parts around. So that was the level of complexity.
Anna.
Yes.
Where's Manfred's?
Manfred wasn't there for the exercise, but he was there for the discussion. So he shows up when he needs to.
In his head.
Right, yeah. Okay, so yeah, great. But more seriously, the aggregate results showed us a lot about what our group was thinking they were going to be doing. So in these two slides, I have pulled out the visual characteristics from the cells and cyborg cells that differentiated them. And then they had some similarities here in the middle. What I think the most important thing we learned is that cyborg meant something really different to all of our researchers. There were three just like non-mutually exclusive ideas of like what a successful cyborg cell would do or look like. And the only way we could really tease that out, I think, was by drawing, because no one had said any of this before the exercise. So it was a good project. And from it, we learned that images are intermediaries between researchers and their concepts, or agents by which the researchers communicate them. They reveal the assumptions that researchers from different knowledge systems can hold, and that allows for the detection of divergence and convergence of certain knowledge systems. And then images influence or literally shape what scientists end up generating in the physical world, thereby shaping emerging parts of a knowledge system. So I conducted an experiment with scientists here. I've been walking around today. I've noticed you all have a lot of pictures up on the walls and are doing interesting conceptual work with them. So maybe there are interesting things to be done in a similar vein, stuff you guys do here. Cool. So the next case, seeing cells, is in some ways a prequel to the one that we just saw. The scientists that we were talking about, their images of cells and cyborg cells held clear conceptual patterns, and those patterns are inherited from somewhere. What they thought cells looked like and do was likely informed at one point or another by images of cells. And I assume this has to be the case because for the first few centuries of the cell concept, it was only documented through images. So taken together, those images can tell us more about the evolution of that particular knowledge system. So this is a panel from an exhibit that is opening next month at the Marine Biological Laboratory. So as part of the Cyborg Cell Project, the humanities sociologist side, we built a historical slash artistic exhibit. I work with Jane Meinschein and Dr. Carl Matlin at the Marine Biological Lab, and it traces the evolution of the cell concept through images. So this panel, presenting and representing the cell, is actually my favorite because it has a really good lesson for viewers. So I will tell you that lesson now. So in the late 19th century, the first biology textbooks were getting published. And they were getting published because they finally had enough people on board with cell theory that they had a unifying initial unit to sort of group together all living organisms, therefore biology. And so in these biology textbooks, they all start, the first chapter is always about cells and cell theory. And so all of the examples and images of cells that they have are specific cells. They are a human epithelial cell. They are a goat ovum. So it is something embedded in the real world and something that you could see under a microscope. And then a little later down the line, a little into the early 20th century, you get the emergence of this picture, which is a slightly diagrammatic cell, and slightly diagrammatic is actually what the caption is for it, which is funny because it implies that it has something to do. It is somewhat embedded in the real world, but at the same time, it has been simplified. There are parts labeled. And then finally, as time goes on, you get instances of fully diagrammatic cells. And so after there's the first fully diagrammatic cell, you start to get more and more iterations of a diagrammatic cell as time goes on. And if you've ever taken a cell biology class, these things still exist even today. I think the interesting thing is when you ask most people what a cell is or what they think a cell looks like, they draw something much closer to a diagrammatic cell than they do to any sort of cell out in the world, potentially, including the scientists we were working with in the cyborg cell team, even though the fact that their experiments were actually going to be done on specific kinds of cells out in the world. So, so what can we learn from that? An individual image can be a condensed version of the history of its knowledge system. So the first image of a cell that gets published in a textbook sort of shows us up until that point what the greatest or most concrete examples of cell and showing what a cell could be are. And then changes in series of images reflect changes in other aspects of the knowledge system. So in the case of the diagrammatic cell, as time goes on, you get different features included, some things fall out of style, some things are added, and that's partially because microscopes are changing, so they can see more things. It also partly reflects which structures scientists are most interested in investigating further. And so the things they choose to look at end up codified in these images. Finally, changes in images signal changes in the static of science, the status of knowledge about scientific entities, meaning that we've seen now in the work that, not us here, but me, I've seen that in other instances in which you have series of images of a microscopic entity, you always start with some real world phenomenon. And then over time, you get these iterations of diagrammatic phenomenon that sort of indicate what stage in the conflict, what stage of utility that concept has for its field. And this could potentially point to signs of developmental patterns in knowledge systems more broadly. Cool. So we've covered images as social agents. We've covered images as historical ledgers. So now we'll see what happens when we treat one image as both. Okay. So I don't know how much microbiology you guys know, but this is Anton van Leeuwenhoek. He is credited today as sort of the first person to make scientific observations of microorganisms in the 17th century. This letter, I will not read the whole thing, was about his microscopical observations of scurf of the teeth, which is just dental plaque, worms in the nose, which is just nose hairs, and then cuticular consisting of scales, which was just human skin patterns. This is, I think, in popular culture today, his most famous letter, and you'll see a little bit of that later. He writes this letter to the Royal Society. It's actually not the first letter he's written about microorganisms. So I think it's really funny that this is the most popular letter because you'll see that people claim it is the first one. It's not. It's just the first one for which we have pictures included still. And so this section in the L over here for you are the drawings that go with this particular letter. And this section in the box is the image that gets reproduced a lot today. There is one problem though, which is that H does not belong with A through G. H belongs with K through M. H is a drawing of a cuticular structure. And so what's happening here? So I have receipts. Here is a page from Brock Biology of Microorganisms, which is a very standard microbiology text from 2018. Here's the Leeuwenhoek image. In fact, they have labeled H as packets of cocci, which is not true. They probably didn't read the original letter, and that's okay. Here is a tweet from the Royal Society in 2018, where they have the image again. They also call it the first time he made a description of a molecule. Not true, historian, annoying historian walking in, but here's the image again. Here is a blog post from the Federation of European Microbiologists in 2020. Same picture, same claims. Actually, International Microorganism Day is on the wrong day. If we want it to be the first day, description was made, but that's okay. And finally, because it wouldn't be fair, this is a slide that I presented a lot in my early years of grad school, where I would excitedly tell everyone, like, look, Anton van Leeuwenhoek drew pictures of microbial aggregates. It's not true. I also had not read the letter, but now I know better. It's a good historian, I guess. So I guess the question here is, what's going on? Part of it has to do with our own modern concept of microorganisms. We're actually used to thinking about microbes as parts of groups. The present state of our knowledge system influences how we interpret historical images. But if you've been listening, I don't think you can have a sort of conceptual explanation of that without an explanation of how the image itself is acting in this way to help people misinterpret what it is like. So right now what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk you through a qualitative interpretation, something that I would do as a historian to figure out how the image is interacting with its knowledge system. Partly going to do it because it's fun for me, and then also because it illustrates the process that I kind of am going to seek to automate during my postdoc. Okay, so let's start with the entire plate. Assume that somebody who was mistakenly pulling this image out to publish in their blog or their book or whatever, went to the Royal Society digital database and pulled up this full plate where these images exist. Most people probably don't do that, but let's pretend. This figure, this plate, was produced at a time when figures that accompanied scientific publications were all engraved and printed together because it was too costly and too hard to put them in text. And so these are all of the images that accompanied all of the letters that the Royal Society published on that year in 1684. And so they're all together is the point. Printers have to maximize figure size, taking into account variable details and needs. So a good example is how this hand, this is a Nehemiah Grew drawing, this hand has to be a lot bigger than the rest of these figures because of the detailed organic lines. In an engraving process, these would never come through unless this figure was of this size. So there is one choice, but printers also have tried to achieve adequate spacing of the sections of figures such that a reader can tell that certain things belong together and do not. And then finally, the different sort of drawing styles of each are another indication that these things might be discrete from each other. Cool. So then we can zoom in to Leeuwenhoek's particular figures that we are interested in. So for spacing considerations, H is underneath A through G, even though it accompanies K through M. Unclear why they made that choice, but there it is. There's no scale bar, and so we infer things that are closer in proximity and closer in size must be conceptually related. Next, we can consider the visual qualities of A through G as opposed to K through M. K through M is larger. The detail is greater, such that some of the features have been labeled. Bold, straight outlines and long linear shading on K through M give the scales a sort of flattened appearance, while the rounded shadows on A through H make the objects appear relatively three-dimensional and organic, like the animalcules Leeuwenhoek was describing. And so finally, the rightward skew of some of these spheres in H kind of create this undulating quality that feels closer to G than it does to the static scales. And finally, we can think about H on its own. The 3D ovals appear to be multiples of the same entity. They are closely packed, making it reasonable to assume they're connected. Vertical edges of the rectangles in the lower left corner draw the eye down and the spheres are above it, such that the spheres look like they are sitting atop whatever it is the rectangles are representing in this case. So the visual features of H does make it, I think, a convincing group of microbes, but alas, it is not. So finally, we can briefly think about the modes of reproduction. Originally, we wanted to be generous and assume people went to the source and cropped this out. And actually, our cropping tools on the computer are squares. So you would have to crop it out like that. And a lot of people don't have the tools or the know-how or the time to take out H, even if they knew it shouldn't be there. So they did it. And then you can imagine one person puts this up on their blog. This image is out of copyright. So it is open. There are no legal or financial barriers to reproducing this image erroneously over and over. So this is what we can learn. Image meaning can change without the image changing. And when this does happen, it signals changes in other components of the knowledge system. So people are changing, cultures are changing, disciplines and their problems, they can change if the image has gone through some sort of interpretive transformation. Finally, patterns in reproduction reveals factors influencing the knowledge system evolution. Great. So up until now, all of my cases were constructed using complex system science. But over the course of my graduate studies, I have been more and more convinced that the best way to model the evolution of scientific concepts is through complex system methods, like networks. So currently, I'm tracing the evolution of the biofilm concept, and no surprise, I think that analysis requires images to be included. And I've done some things to start, but in order to do the network analysis of the evolution of the biofilm concept in a way that is satisfactory to me while centering images, I need more time and different tools that don't exist yet. And so this is what I hope to achieve during my postdoc. So first, I'm going to give you some background to the project, a little bit about what I found so far, and then where I hope to take it in a year's time. So some definitions. First, I'm taking the biofilm concept to mean a sessile microbial aggregate. Sessile meaning stationary or stuck. I want to know how this concept emerged and evolved to eventually shape the concerns of modern microbiology. And the biofilm concept is actually a really great starting point for understanding microbiology today, because it's actually a conceptual precursor to things like microbiomes and holobionts. And so, however, you wouldn't know that by reading histories about these concepts and their respective subfields in microbiology. The very small amount which do exist have mostly been written by microbiologists who are alive today and by popular science writers. And these histories are not what I would necessarily call comprehensive. And in fact, when you read them, they all happen to make the same group of claims, which I have outlined here. So understanding microorganisms, complex groups like biofilms, it's revolutionary. It actually represents a new microbiology. There's actually a textbook that came out rather recently that is called The New Microbiology that backs all this up, which is wonderful. It's closer to truth, aka how microbes exist in nature. It will change the world. And it started around the year 2000 and was made possible by second generation genomics methods. And these things are specifically referring to the concept, like the idea that microbes exist as groups, which is exciting. So, cool. To add to the hype, one of my favorite papers published in 2019, it claims that 40 to 80% of cells on Earth exist in biofilms and therefore affect all biogeochemical processes. So I think it's clear how the stakes riding on the biofilm concept and microorganisms as complex systems more broadly are actually quite high. I think that the only way to know the utility of our modern concepts is to understand them relative to the past so that we can articulate our current problems as scientists and as people and to figure out if those concepts that we have inherited are still serving us in the ways we need them to. So, these histories claim all these things, which even when I was a baby grad student and I took them at face value, I was still kind of bothered by it. Because if it's true that most microorganisms are out in the world existing in this biofilm way, how is it possible that people who have been observing microbes directly for about 300 years never thought this was important or significant? And so that was sort of my entry into the issue. So, how am I answering it? How am I doing this investigation? It's kind of exactly the question that I think complex system methods will help. So again, histories of the biofilm concept are not super comprehensive. So using bibliographic networks to sort of reconstruct early scientific discourse about biofilms is probably one of the quickest and best ways to get a broad understanding of what was happening in a time when we don't have histories that explain it yet. Like most bibliographic network studies, I needed to generate a corpus of publications to answer my question. So I did the obvious thing and I went to a database like Scopus, which is the only one I have access to through my university. And I looked up publications that fell under the term biofilm, and there were approximately 60,000 from 1975 to 2021. But as a good historian, I had already been talking to biofilm researchers who worked at my university, and I knew they were working on these problems in earnest in the 1960s. So this corpus wasn't going to work for my needs. So what I did is I built my own corpus based off of some of the earlier publications in the Scopus corpus, and I did a snowball sampling method. So sort of reading through references and picking out any papers that were alluding to biofilms. And interestingly enough, if you read the dissertations of people who were working on biofilm science in the 60s, they weren't calling them biofilms. There were lots of terms that describe this phenomenon. And so this corpus has a bunch of those papers in it. And then I wanted to generate networks. So I built the corpus, I cleaned the corpus, took forever, it was awful. And so now I'm using VOS Viewer, which is a software that builds bibliometric networks to generate these particular kinds of networks for the single years, for decades, and then for the entire corpus. And so I'm doing co-author networks and co-citation networks by author and by publication. By generating these networks, I'm hoping to identify general structures of subfields and also identify the most influential people and papers from each sort of group of analyses. And so the goal basically is, I'm not going to get a ton into the data today, partly because I'm still doing it, but here are the results from 1964, just so you get a sense of what they look like. I think generally they're reflecting these subfield divisions that I expected to see. Again, the advantage of modeling discourse in this way is quick, it's relatively reliable, and it's coarse-grained enough that I feel like I'm being comprehensive, even though I know I don't have every single paper that could potentially be in there. I think once you build these networks, it actually, and you build them for so many years, you can kind of see where subfields might be missing. So you might be missing a paper in that year. So that's been very helpful visually. Great. So analysis isn't done. As I said, But just building the corpus by hand and then seeing the initial networks has helped me to generate sort of this broad picture of biofilm science before they were calling it that. Once I have a more detailed idea of these structures and the influential people and papers in them, my process is going to be to pull the images out of those papers and then trace cases of coevolution of images and concepts about the biofilm, about microbial biofilms. And so this is what I have to do before I graduate in a year. And today I'm gonna give you one example of what I hope to document more of, and it's from dental microbiology. So here are three images. The first two were present in publications in my snowball corpus, and the last image was present in the scopus corpus. And so if you cannot tell, these are all of the same biofilm structure, if we're gonna use modern terms. And so in 1899, they did light microscopy on people's teeth plaque. They found these structures, which they called, they gave it a species because at the time taxonomy is what they were doing. They called it Leptothrix racemosa. And then the original reason they were interested in it is because they thought that it was the cause of dental caries, because back then that is what dentists were trying to figure out. But it happened to be present in both diseased and normal mouths at such regularity that they moved on, and then they repurposed the idea. And they said this, they thought that this whole structure was a single organism. And in fact, that this single organism was the, they used the word birth, the birth giver to all the mouth microbes in people. And you can fast forward to the 1970s, electron microscopy was just, it wasn't new, but it was just starting to get applied to more biological issues in terms of microbes. And they found these and they called them corn cobs. They hypothesized that these are two different species having some sort of interaction, but they make no claims about taxonomy. They don't even like seriously claim that they are two. They just said they probably are. They're hedging because at this time, when they're establishing sort of what things look like at this scale, they're still integrating past knowledge. And then finally, in 2016, they have images of the corn cup structure again, this time with confocal fluorescence. And now they have dyed certain components of the genome in these microorganisms to fluoresce different colors, reflecting species that are meaningfully different to researchers. And they do this because they want to know how and why biofilms form this way regularly in mouths. And so this sort of example of how you can see core images in a biological subfield, you can start to pull apart historical and conceptual issues that move across the network. Cool. So that's all great. and I have a lot more to do. But here's the thing, it's pretty hard. This combination of quantitative networks and qualitative image analysis works really well for small sets of images, but I would like to do broader sets. And currently I have to rely on the bibliometric networks to guide image choice. But I really want to let images lead if that were possible. And I think this analysis would really benefit greatly from having quantitative data about the images that isn't just me making judgments about what's happening. So I can't do this at the scale that I think would be best suited for understanding concept image coevolution, but I do think software can help. And that is exactly what I propose to do in my postdoc. So I'll show you like a rough ideation of what in the dream world, maybe at this baby stage, it would do. So we would put in images as inputs, and it would also include metadata that the user could generate. And so it would be put into this software. And then the software could process and annotate image files through machine learning. We could start by training it on the large database of images that I'm going to generate during the rest of my dissertation. And then this tool will organize and present the image networks that hopefully represent relationships between user-selected variables. And those could be metadata variables or AI-generated parameters. I'm really excited by the idea of trying to have an AI define styles of microbial things. I think that would be a fun challenge. And so a good initial experiment, I think, would be to compare the results from image networks generated on the biofilm images that I'll have and compare them to sort of the qualitative analysis that I'm going to do. And then we can study how accurate or effective image networks might be at representing evolving knowledge systems. So I'm calling these guys conceptual storms, but maybe you could call them knowledge systems. I kind of feel like in my brain, they're moving and changing through time, and they're composed of and also exerting force on other storms which exist. And they include material entities like technologies and people and non-material entities like culture. And we choose to study conceptual change through words alone. I imagine that we are kind of doing a spinal tap into like the densest, most material center of these storms. So we know they're there, but I think we can get a broader view of what's happening. So images are a bit coarser grained. They sort of act as condensed versions of states of knowledge systems. And so by leveraging them in experiments, I think we can pull apart the complexity of these conceptual storms a little bit more. And once I can do this at scale, I think we could actually model such storms, which is something I'd like to explore down the road. And I think here would be a really good place to do it. So looking forward, this framework as an addition and the addition of a tool like the one that I hope to build, I hope will improve how we study complex knowledge systems like science. And that's it.
So one thing I like about you built this snowball corpus in the past is that it seems like in the digital humanities, especially, you know, when we're using, well, the tools that everybody uses, that it's really hard to tell the difference between the emergence of a new word and the emergence of a new concept, mm-hmm. since often people are coining a new word for a pre-existing concept.
Yeah.
And so you use citation networks to do that. Do you think there are other ways to do that, that, you know, track how concepts change and move through the literature, even if there aren't explicit citations?
Yeah, and that's a good question. We've investigated a situation in the past where the historian actually thought people were purposefully not citing somebody. So to try to pull out instances that like you could trace an idea in a paper back to someone without an explicit citation, I did the bibliometric networks, and someone else did sort of natural language processing to compare language in certain papers to language in later papers and to see if like those trends stick over time, and you can have dates as sort of cutoff points. So if they're not using the word before this author's paper is published in 1980, then we can reasonably, we can keep going on the hypothesis that maybe they're using his ideas but not citing him. So there's that. I also think you could use institutional connections. I think it's hard because we sort of, I think, put most of our stock into like concepts will be present in the publications, and references might be, besides actually looking at the text itself, references might be the most reliable way of like at least saying the concepts in these two papers have something to do with each other. I think that's the whole theory behind co-citation. Does that answer your question? I gave you one.
Sort of related to that is maybe this is too recent for historical purposes, but I've often wondered why historians don't use NIH as a database. That is grant submissions, mm-hmm. grants that are funded, grants that weren't funded. A lot of that information is available.
Mm-hmm.
And it in many ways traces the history of an idea, it seems to me, more effectively than papers do,
mm-hmm.
because this is what scientists are sort of proposing or thinking about right at the edge, some of which will never come to pass as a paper.
Yeah, if you don't care about attribution to a particular person, then I think grants would be really helpful. I actually tried to get a bunch of grant reports for my early corpus, and it's very hard because they don't have them digitized. So if you request like a government document, like who knows how long it will take. But yeah, for modern things, I think that'd be very useful. Yeah.
Very nice talk. At the very beginning, when you presented the cyborg cell, it was really interesting to see that nobody presented some sort of actual conceptual process, mm-hmm. like gene regulatory network, yeah. etc., inside the cell. And if you go to textbooks today, this is full of that.
Mm-hmm.
It is simply a square or an oval full of some sort of a network, which are capturing a concept that scientists are thinking about.
Right.
And I have not seen any of that here. Mm-hmm. What is the role of that conceptual model of how cell actually function is in your work?
Like a conceptual diagram?
Yeah.
I am working through sort of what I mean by image is a good question. And I think it will depend, at least for my questions, on the images that I end up finding in the corpus. I have a feeling that in the beginning, it will be very literal, just sort of microphotographic. And then as concepts develop, we will get more of these sort of conceptual diagrams that now that we agree that the entity exists in a certain way, we can start to extrapolate on what we think it's doing or how we think it's doing it. And that is much easier for some people to show in diagrams. I think video is actually a really interesting example of like people trying to capture these now conceptual diagrams of processes in the real world to like bolster their argument of the concept. So it's a good question. Actually, one of the cyborg cell groups, it wasn't our group, but they are doing gene regulatory networks as their main focus of building their synthetic cell. So yeah.
Thanks. If you could elaborate a little bit more on what you mean by social agents.
Uh-huh.
Just a social agents.
Sure. I think the best example is that I would like to argue that images are doing work that doesn't necessarily have to be ascribed to a person. So we can almost treat them like an active participant, a social agent in a network, as opposed to just assuming there's some sort of passive conveyor of ideas and it's like all up to the person. So I think it gives more agency to the picture and the features of the picture in the system.
Have you thought any about simulation outputs as a type of image that's grown in the biofilm field?
In terms of like modeling?
People have a model, but then they actually show you the explicit spatial output of that model or detailed gradients in the biofilm or any of those.
Yeah, I've started working with Aaron Dinner at University of Chicago, and he does computational modeling of cells. So we are moving in that direction, and I'm not the expert in that, but like that would be the next sort of like, now you've created some sort of three-dimensional spatial representation of a real life thing, and now you're going to propose. Like there are so many things you can propose to do with it. Like, okay, I say this accurately models the real world, or no, like now I want to build something that doesn't exist, but this model, this computational form gives it support that you should give me money to do it, basically. So we're thinking about it. I don't have a deeper answer than that. I'm sorry.
Sorry, so I actually teach biology, or at least neurobiology. And I sometimes wonder or worry that the graphics in the textbooks, while they're good conceptually, they hide a lot from students, as it were. I mean, so I have a pathway, I have an intracellular pathway of signaling, let's say. And what the textbook has are a bunch of sort of lumpy looking proteins of different colors and arrows, you know, and when this protein and that protein attach, they change color or something like that. But the kinetic equations that govern all this are left out. And that seems to me to be a key part of understanding how these things work. You know, we have a lock and key image of receptor and ligand interactions, which is not really the true story. And yet it's the conceptual story that everybody learns.
Yeah.
So I worry sometimes that the conceptual imagery can hide some of the crucial details.
Right, which is why it's good to ask sort of why certain kinds of images appear in certain places. And it also probably depends on what your students end up doing. Like if they're going to be neuroscientists, maybe you don't want them to have the mistaken idea. But maybe if they're just someone studying neuroscience and they're never going to do it again, it's enough. I also think that there might be a way to actually incorporate kinetics or like do visualizations of kinetics that are like conceptual. There's no such thing as a correct conceptual diagram. You can represent anything in a multitude of ways. It's just, what does it allow you to achieve? So to your point, I think like you can get more creative with conceptual diagrams.
My field is psychology, and we often have the discussion about concepts or even images that put people on the wrong track. So a famous example is photographic memory.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very often used concept, but actually people having this type of memory, they're putting using this word photographic memory actually is quite misleading. Mm-hmm. And there are lots of examples in psychology actually, but does this happen in your field?
Of photographic memory? Or
no, that there are certain images or concepts that are, yeah.
Oh, sure, a biofilm is a great one. Well, I mean, part of it is the concept of a film is that it's a two-dimensional object, and that kind of like, I think for a decade was a thing. And then once they started doing more microscopic observation, they realized the three-dimensional structure of it was quite important for its function. And so you can see instances where people make claims about biofilms that depend upon them being two-dimensional because that's how they were shown, but they're not. And so it's not a great heuristic in that case. So yeah. It does happen. Yeah.
So kind of piggybacking on these last few questions, this seems like a much harder area to address, but you know, there's a lot of people have made arguments about not just the development of scientific concepts, but the emergence of sort of conceptual space within which scientific discoveries are made possible.
Mm-hmm.
And the flow between innovations in the arts and innovations in the sciences, like, you know, Leonard Schlein's book, Art and Physics, talking about, like, for instance, the innovation of cubism and its relationship to relativity theory. So I'm curious about how much you've thought about that and like how you feel that would stand as a horizon for this kind of research.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's, again, at this point I like to make a lot, but most things you can represent in like a million different ways, and pulling novel form or novel color or novel visual features to think about an idea, I think really helps humans, especially humans who think more strongly spatially, to sort of break out of inherited ideas about what things are. I think something really interesting that would be fun. There's, I don't know how much everyone knows about Barbara McClintock, but when people write about her and what she did for microbiology, they like to say like, oh, she didn't listen to anyone. She went so against the grain. And in my head, what she did was she looked at what was happening to the genes that she could see, and she didn't put any sort of conceptual barriers on the actual visual phenomenon, which allowed her to make observations that other people claimed, like, there's no way you can be right, because they were still working with those concepts over them. And so there is something about like visual features without conceptual baggage that I think can be very generative for science. That's something I'd be interested in studying more. Yeah.
Did you have anything else?
Yeah, I guess just one more question, which comes sort of from Stuart. So I guess when you're learning about the cell, which or when you're failing to learn about it because it was many years ago, there are these, I guess we have all these different sort of technological metaphors which we could try to apply. Like, you know, we were thrilled, many of us, to see these movies of a little thing spinning around, like, oh, it's a gear, you know, or as you said, it's a key and a lock. And of course, it's somewhere in between like mechanical engineering and liquid phase chemistry with kinetics. And it's confusing, and we don't have a good kind of human scale metaphor for what it is. And so we slide back and forth between those. And I'm sure how images are presented does a huge amount of reinforcement of those. Yeah. One specific thing I was curious about, since one of the first things you showed is that like the diagrammatic cell is this simple blob, whereas a lot of real cells are these very complex shapes.
Mm-hmm.
And I was curious like how these images at some stage reinforce the picture of the interior of the cell as a liquid medium where things are swimming around and bumping into each other chemically, as opposed to what we've been hearing the last few years, which is it's actually quite rigid, very gel-like, all this active transport, cytoskeleton stuff, and so on.
Yeah, there's this great Twitter post that always gets like it always goes viral on science Twitter whenever someone republishes it, and it's like a kinetic model, but it's like it's a model of a cell, but like all of the parts are just like vibrating really fast and like hitting each other and moving, and then all of the comments are like, that's what nature is, like that's the real thing, like people are so happy to see it represented like in motion, and it's it's almost, yeah, I think people's responses to certain images sort of show what kinds of concepts have been reinforced through other ways to see the cell. To your point where cells in real life have these crazy shapes, our actual traditional cell biologist of the group, so he's not a physicist, he's not an engineer. He basically just manipulates real cells all day. And he was so happy, this is our logo for our team. He was so happy when I presented a star instead of a circle, because he was like, that's the shape of the cells that I work with. And so he had a very concrete connection to this thing. So yeah, to your point, I mean, again, for microscopic entities, particularly, we can't see them without pictures. Like we rely on the pictures so much so that like, I mean, most people conflate a picture with that's how the world is, when we know like the transformation that's happening through the microscope, like who knows how the world is there? We get certain traces from this scale and we can make ideas about it and do things with those ideas. I think I'm sort of rambling now, but I think, again, I don't think there are like, right or wrong answers. I think there are things that work to do things that scientists want them to do. And when they stop working, they say like, we need a different representation. And then they move on. It's very rare that like someone is just looking for a new representation just because they want to.
And I guess the round blobby diagrammatic cell makes us think of a water droplet.
Hmm.
And then we see other round blobby things inside it. We're like, oh, cool, a droplet containing other droplets.
Mm-hmm.
But none of that conveys the idea of, you know, rigid, complicated structures moving these droplets around deliberately. It's more like, oh, it's a cell has organelles in it, sort of the same way a drop of water has animalcules in it. They're all swimming around, you know, everything's very liquid and I don't know.
Yeah, and it's funny to find out, like, when people find out certain visual tropes are not useful to them. Like you'll meet a PhD student who's like, oh, I didn't know that cells weren't this thing until like this stage in my studies. And it's like, how? It's because the representations you saw were of a specific thing for so long. But yeah.
Anna's going to be around and available for the next 2 days. Is meeting with some of us, but also feel free to obviously to catch her in the hallways or in her office. And then she'll be involved in the postdoc workshop after that. So let's thank Anna again.
Thank you.